Hello. Thank you, and thank you for helping Brian before. That was so nice of you. I'm welcome to the World Science Festival and to this this fascinating subject that we're going to be talking about tonight. What is it that makes us human? This is the second year we've had a conversation about this subject of who we think we are. You know, we tend to think of ourselves as unique, as way different from the other animals. And if we are so different, what is it that distinguishes us? What is it that makes us human? And then the really tough question is, how did we get that way? And tonight there'll be a special focus on the on the enigma of altruism. And apparently, this has been an enigma since the time of the guy who invented evolution. Isn't that funny? I have so much in my head here, I can't remember Darwin's name. So this was an enigma for Darwin, too. I mean, he was thinking about one particular aspect of altruism in the behavior of ants. And he said that he wrote that it was one special difficulty which at first appeared insuperable and actually fatal to the whole theory. I mean, he was afraid that this question of altruism could annihilate. He said, use the word annihilate, the theory of evolution. So what is it about altruism that's such a problem? How could it have threatened the theory of evolution? I think we're going to get some interesting, fascinating answers to those questions from the distinguished group of scientists who are joining us tonight. Please welcome Xavier Le Pichon, Rob Boyd, Dominic Johnson, Sarah Hrdy, and Edward O. Wilson. Well, thank God you're here. I forgot Charles Darwin's name. before we get into our talk, now that the audience can see your faces, I'd like to tie your faces and your names in a word or two about your interests together. Xavier Le Pichon, on the far right, is one of the founders of the modern theory of plate tectonics. Pardon me. In 1991, he was named the world's most highly cited scientist. He spent nearly 30 years living in a community of cognitively impaired people in the French countryside, and that led him to study whether human cooperation is rooted in our ability to recognize suffering in others. Professor Le Pichon visits us from the Collège de France in Aix-en-Provence. Now, next to next to Xavier is anthropologist Rob Boyd. He studies the evolution of cooperation in large groups. By observing hunter-gatherer cultures around the world, he has examined the importance of culture to human adaptation, including our ability to cooperate with one another. He's a professor at UCLA in California. Next to him is Dominic Johnson. Thank you. Dominic Johnson's interest in both political science and evolutionary biology has led him to study the evolution of human cooperation. He's researching the role, I believe, of religion in cooperative behavior at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland, where he is an associate professor. Sarah Hrdy, a leading primatologist and award-winning author, has made significant contributions to the field of evolutionary biology through her work on mothering in humans and in primates, other primates. She's Professor Emerita at UC Davis. And Edward O. Wilson. For those of you who didn't break spontaneously into applause, he's the evolutionary biologist and Pulitzer Prize winner, and arguably the world's most famous authority on ants. And among other landmark achievements, he founded the field of sociobiology, the study of the biological basis of behavior, including altruism and cooperation in ants and humans. Welcome to you all. Thank you for coming. Just so we're all in the same boat here and, on the same page, I'd like to get a couple of things defined. How about altruism? I mean, we think we have a glimmer of it when we talk about an altruistic person. Is it the same with the other animals? Is it the same as cooperation? Can we use those words interchangeably? Sarah, what do you think?
Cooperation is helping someone else, and you may benefit from helping that other individual, in which case it's a kind of mutual act. If the other individual benefits and you don't, the actor doesn't, that's altruistic.
Ah, okay. So when we talk about the enigma of altruism, is there a similar, does that enigma spill over into a cooperation as well, or does that kind of remain? Can that remain an act in which is slightly selfish?
There's nothing that enigmatic about cooperation per se. All kinds of creatures cooperate, starting with the ones Ed was telling me about before we met. The social insects that are responsible for what, two-thirds of the biomass?
Insects are two-thirds of the biomass, is that right?
Yeah, they own the world.
So it doesn't do anything. It doesn't help to keep swatting them. They're not going to, you'll never get anywhere with that.
No, that's right.
I think Ed would tell you, watch where you step.
Watch where you step.
That's in response to the question I most often ask about ants.
Which is what?
What do I do about the ones in my kitchen? So my answer, if I'm not getting us off on the wrong foot, Alan.
Yes. Is to step the crap out of them.
Well, no. What you do is watch where you step, be careful of little lives, give them pieces of tuna, they especially like that, and lots of honey. And my semi-serious follow-up is, and then get down and watch them, and you will see creatures behaving so differently from human beings that it might be on another planet.
Really? Yeah. Well, it was ants that Darwin was worried about, and it was in terms of how altruistic, apparently, some of them were, right? Wasn't it the ants that didn't give birth were taking care of the queen's offspring?
Right. So how do you get a worker caste evolved? That was the problem.
That's a problem for the
theory.
It's a
very distinct form of life that does not reproduce, and yet they're everywhere. So his solution was what he called the well-flavored vegetable. He said the way to look at it is that the queen is the unit of natural selection, and that the worker ants can be thought of, these non-reproducing ants that were taking care of her, could be thought of as comparable to a well-flavored vegetable that's cultivated by the gardener, but it's not the vegetable that is selected, it is the plant that produces the vegetable. That's how Darwin weaseled out of it.
you were able to reduce the sociobiology to a statement that you could say while standing on one foot, I think.
Oh,
like,
well,
Rabbi Hillel.
Yeah, you're well read.
Oh, thank you. So Rabbi Hillel could cite the essence of the Torah roughly by saying, standing on one foot and saying, Don't do to somebody else what you wouldn't want done to you.
That is correct.
And the rest is commentary.
That's right.
So what would you say about sociobiology if you had to get up and do it on one foot?
Well, it would be with reference to the whole issue of altruistic societies. And it would this is something that my colleague, David Sloan Wilson, no relation, and I, put out at the conclusion of an argument overthrowing the prevailing theory of kin selection, which had been around for 40 years, and substituting a more rigorous theory of group selection. And we said, quoting, you know, following upon Rabbi Hillel, the 1 foot solution, which is altruistic behavior originates by group selection and all else is commentary. Now, you've forced me into making a provocative statement.
That's okay.
I was going to save that to the end.
No, we got. Okay. I just wanted to tease everybody with that.
All right, fine.
It's a little, as okay. Rabbi Hillel would say, a vorspeise of that, yeah, of the conversation. Okay. And because what happened from the time, like Dominic, can you bring us in on this? What happened from the time Darwin said, uh-oh, the theory's in trouble, what's the solution here? And we seem to have gone through a number of attempts at solutions, and the latest version is this group selection that Ed is proposing rather forcefully now. What were some of the stages we went through?
Okay, well, as you mentioned, the guy who invented evolution, I mean, he was puzzled by the ants and the bees that sting, with a huge sacrifice to their own resources. And after that, I mean, people didn't worry about it too much. You had a lot of just-so stories about evolution, that it was for the good of the group or the good of the species, and people got away with that for many decades. And Darwin's puzzle wasn't really solved until the middle of the last century now, by W.D. Hamilton initially, who proposed this idea of kin selection, that it's okay if I help you. If you share my genes, then it's still selfish from the genetic perspective. So that was a significant step forward. And then a few years later, there was the theory of reciprocity, which was proposed by Robert Trivers, which is very simple. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. So a reciprocal arrangement. Yes, I will behave apparently altruistic in one given instance, but the benefit will be returned later on. Mm. And then more recently, people have got interested in indirect reciprocity. So maybe I'm altruistic to other people, and they're not going to give me anything in return. But by being altruistic, I'm attracting other people to direct their resources towards me. So these three solutions have been extremely successful in explaining animal cooperation, what used to be thought of as animal altruism. The problem remains, though, for humans, because humans still cooperate with people they're not related to in anonymous settings, one-shot encounters, they're never going to see them again. So none of these theories can, on the face of it, explain the incredible puzzle of human cooperation. So Darwin's puzzle has been solved for the animal world to some extent, although there's still many controversies. But the human puzzle of cooperation certainly remains, and people on this panel are working hard to figure out what's going on.
Was kin selection an intermediate an attempt to refine the notion of group selection that Darwin started to propose?
Well, I think it developed independently. It was really, what's incredible is if you think about what Darwin achieved without any knowledge of genes. And it wasn't until the middle of last century that we figured out what genes were and that they were a very important unit of selection. So that raised the possibility of knowing that we share genes with other individuals means we can explain cooperation and apparent altruism through the selfish gene idea. So group selection, although Darwin had sort of raised it himself, kin selection wasn't a way of getting back to group selection. It was initially seen as a very different sort of explanation. So you could be a selfish gene theorist and understand kin selection and cooperation.
But the idea being, if you help somebody who has your genes because they're kin to you, then you are, in fact, helping your own genes.
Exactly. So I jump into a river to save two of my brothers or four of my cousins.
It's just that it's the wrong theory.
He says so gently, he says, it's just that it's the wrong theory. Good, good, good. Okay. We're going to get to that. I want to, for the last year or so, there have been some questions in my mind. I'd really like to ask you these questions based on a show that I've been working on with Graham Shedd of the show is called The Human Spark, and it's going to be on public television in November. And we went all around the world talking to people about what was this spark that happened at some point in the history of humanity that made us different, made us special. And in the clip I want to show you, we talked to Franz de Waal and Tomasello about this thing that we share with other animals, which is cooperation, which they have, but we have it apparently to a much more developed degree. Let's start this. The clip starts with an old film that Franz de Waal found that you may all have seen and may not agree with either. that seems to show two chimps cooperating on a very difficult task. Let's run that and we can talk about it in a second. Franz de Waal recently unearthed a film made at Yerkes in the 1930s, where two young chimpanzees clearly seem to be cooperating on a task. It involves both of them pulling together on ropes to get a food reward.
So they have to be well coordinated to do this.
So even if you train them to pull, you cannot train, I don't see how you can train them to be so coordinated. Mm-hmm. So try this with two cats. You will never get two cats to do this. Now the movie says that they made one of them hungry, the other one is not hungry. So only one of them is highly motivated, the other one doesn't care anymore.
Yeah. Come on over.
Yeah, they do that. So this is
the hungry chimp seems to be encouraging his partner, who's not hungry, to help him get the food. Interpreting the film is controversial. It's not known just how trained the chimps were, for instance. But several recent experiments have confirmed that two chimps can cooperate in similar tasks, provided that they know and are comfortable with each other. And this seems to be a critical difference with humans.
So humans actually have already a capacity to get along with their neighbors more than chimps do. But then in addition, in our modern society, that's of course unprecedented what we do. If you would put 10 million chimps in New York City, you know, I don't think you would have the same kind of city. There would be a bloodbath, basically.
So here we seem close to a major break with chimpanzees. While we've seen that they can do many things once thought of as exclusively human, to use tools, imitate, keep track of who's done favors to whom, what we have that they don't, what comes closest, perhaps, to being the human spark, is our ability to get along, even with people we don't know. It's something Mike Tomasello calls a sense of we-ness, of cooperation, collaboration, shared goals and intentions.
If you look from the outside, the things that make humans really different are things like complex technology, symbol systems like language and mathematics, and social institutions like governments and religions. And the question is, what does it take to participate in these things? And what it takes to participate in these cultural products is being able to put your head together with others and to communicate with others, cooperate with others, and exchange information with others in a cultural group.
So, Rob, you were sort of shaking your head when I first began to talk about that. You knew what clip was coming up with the two chimps apparently cooperating.
Actually, I've never seen that clip before, but...
You have seen it?
I have not seen it.
Oh, not seen it. What do you think? Do you think that they were, in fact, cooperating, or is it, well, maybe nobody knows if they were actually trained to do that?
Right. So there's been a bunch of experiments done more recently where we have a lot more control, and there's an experiment very much like that one done by Tomasello and his coworkers. And what I was actually trying to see was how the rope was connected to the box, because in the Tomasello experiment, it's connected through pulleys. So if one individual pulls and the other doesn't pull, the rope just comes through, and that's an example of cooperation as Sarah defined it, because if we both pull together, we get something. If one of us pulls by ourselves, we don't get anything. So there's no way to free ride on this system, yeah. except at the end if you grab the food first. But they fixed it up so that couldn't happen, right? So, but in other experiments where there is free riding possible, experiments done both in the U.S. and at Tomasello's situation in Leipzig, chimps don't seem to care very much about what the other chimp gets. In other words, they'll do work for themselves, but they won't even, so if they're given a choice between something for me and something for the other guy, or just something for me, they, this is done, the U.S. experiment was done by my colleague at UCLA, Joan Silk, they choose at random. Yeah. And so they just don't pay any attention to the existence of the other guy. And so I think, I mean, it's a nice movie, but much better modern experiments suggest that chimps.
Which plays into a little bit what Mike Tomasello was saying when he said, if you had 10 million chimps in New York instead of people, he actually said, you would probably have a bloodbath. Is that, Xavier, do you think that that's true? I mean, are we that much more cooperative than they are?
Well, let me take an example of what I've been living for 30 years in the communities with mentally handicapped that we call LARCH. And when the young people, or not so young, come to help, you know, they say, we come to help out of altruism. And then they spend a few months, and then they discover that they began to empathize with the mentally handicapped. They begin to develop a strong feeling of identity, of sharing. And then they say, now I know I was wrong. You know, I did not come to help. I came to live with them and to put together a community where they will be in the center. Mm. Now, I think this is the founding experience of humanity. When you begin to recognize that somebody else that is lacking something that you have is still somebody with whom you can share at depth, you know, what we call communion, you can call it empathy, you can call it whatever, and that this experience is what makes altruism in man so different.
This is very interesting because there's a piece of video where very young children are helping, and there are a couple of chimps that also can help, but to a much more limited degree, but the kids, these little kids, seem impelled to help. Can we run that clip? And I'd like you to talk about that, to comment on Xavier's statement. What's the next clip we have here? The most ambitious attempt to compare the skills of humans and our non-human relatives, and in particular our social skills, is taking place in Leipzig, Germany, where the zoo houses one of the world's largest collections of apes. Here, Mike Tomasello and his team at the Max Planck Institute for Evolutionary Anthropology are testing both apes and children.
Haha! Ich habe noch mehr. Guck hier. So. Und hier. Und hier. Oh! So. Und hier. Fertig.
Let's see, I put this one up here, and then I'll just put this one up.
The help the kids gave was entirely spontaneous.
Thank you. Dankeschön. Okay, all done.
The surprise was that chimps also volunteer to help when an object is out of reach.
So this suggests that potentially altruistic motivation to act on behalf of others is something that is shared among chimpanzees and humans, mm-hmm. and therefore something that maybe was already a characteristic of our common ancestor.
But if the impulse to help has deep evolutionary roots, in humans it has blossomed.
Habe ich da alles reingetan? Guck mal, Schäschen, hier habe ich noch mehr. Huh? Guck, oh. Ui, die sind aber schwer, hä? Guck. Oh. Geht nicht. So und drin. Haha!
While helping in chimps was limited to reaching tasks, human children are eager to help with all sorts of troubles. And what's more, they seem to enjoy it.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Now, you know, it really does look like they have something built in that makes them want to cooperate. But, and I'd be interested to hear what you have to say about that. But I heard something happening tonight in the audience that sort of plays into your studies. There seemed to be this overwhelming response to the sight of the children. We can't resist the sight of children. Does that play into your work on mothering?
I think children are the heart of it. And if you want to understand, you know, the very earliest glimmerings of caring about someone else and wanting to help them, you have to go back 200 million years. You have to go back to mammals and mothers. And this is where the neurological wiring comes from. And as Ed said earlier, everything else is commentary, you know, and there's a lot of elaboration on that. There are a lot of creatures out there, especially primates, where you have group members other than the parents helping to care. When I look at that film of the eagerness to help, I'm not thinking of other apes, because you don't have shared care in other apes. It's just the mother cares for her infant, and that's it. But in a lot of animals, in over half of all 300 plus species of primates, you have some form of shared care that individuals other than the mother help. And at about 20% of those, they're actually offering food. So when I see that film, I'm not thinking chimpanzees. I'm thinking marmosets, something that are, you know, far more distant relatives. 15 million years since we had any common ancestors with them, not just the 7 million years since we had ancestors with chimpanzees. These guys, you have this same giving impulse. The film, the chimps who helped, they had to be begged. They had to be solicited. The guy had to, and the one also, the Ngamba chimps, where they show them offering food, those guys actually, in order to get fed, have to offer their bowl to the keeper. So there was a lot of human socialization going on, and there was a lot of begging. Marmosets, you have this volunteering of help, just unsolicited helping. Judith Burkhart, a woman at the University of Zurich who studies them, refers to these as other regarding preferences, using the term that economists use when they describe this surprising behavior in humans. Because, of course, it has come as a big surprise to economists how eager people were to help.
Did this come, do you think, from the need to bring up children through a long childhood? We have the longest childhood of any primate, right? Probably any
absolutely.
Animal.
It takes 13 million calories to rear a human from birth to nutritional independence.
And I was through with them in the first year or two.
Oh no, well, we think these kids are layabouts because they're still at home at age 19 or 20. Yeah. Among hunter-gatherers, young people are not producing as much as they're consuming until 18, 19, 20, 21. There's nothing new about your kids hanging around.
Yeah, and you know how teenagers eat. But nevertheless, they're cared for not just by the mother, but by other. Is it mostly females that care for the
children?
Well,
that's a very interesting. That depends on the situation and the species. But in humans, first of all, among our hunting and gathering ancestors in the Pleistocene, the period from 1.8 million to about 12,000 years ago, a mother without a lot of help wouldn't be able to rear young that survived and still feed herself. The old story from Darwin onward was, oh yeah, she had a mate and he helped, and he did. The help of men and hunters is extremely important. But the problem with her mate is that he may not survive, he may go elsewhere, he may have bad luck hunting. So you have a lot of sharing among men with the meat they have. But you know, hunting is dicey. And if you depended on game alone, there'd be periods of starvation, even more than the periods of starvation there were. So you had to also buffer yourself with gathered food. And this would involve other females in the group, older siblings, aunts, grandmothers. And of course, grandmothers have this special role in humans because they go on living so much longer after menopause than in other primates. Other primates have menopause. They cease to menstruate at a certain age, but then they die. And human females will go on living for decades afterwards. And that there's that help. So there's a lot of help. In some species, the monkeys I used to study, the helpers are mostly other females. Mm-hmm. In humans, there is a tremendous capacity for nurture in human males. There's all kinds of evidence that makes you realize that a man who's around, for example, babies, his prolactin levels go up, his testosterone levels go down. There's a potential there. It's just so rarely tapped. Because
I think you have the secret to modern life here.
Oh, absolutely. We need more of it.
But now Sarah said it's, in a way, you said it's pretty much all genes, right?
Well,
I mean, you rely heavily on the genetic
Nothing is all genes.
Yeah.
Because genes have to develop in order to be there. And you know, this attractiveness of babies, for example. Yes, we have a genetic predisposition to be attracted to babies, but the cues are coming. We're being bombarded with these adorable signals. So, you know, it's a two-way street.
And it may get reinforced by other people's behavior.
Oh, absolutely. And as Rob will tell us, culture's playing a role in this.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. I mean, I'm not trying to start a fight between them. But I had this funny feeling that maybe you put more stock in culture than Sarah does.
We resolved this in the pre-discussion here before. I think what I would say is that if you want to explain how you get 12 million New Yorkers killing each other where 12 million chimpanzees would, there's a bunch of stages. I mean, there's a whole bunch of changes that have to take place. I'm mainly interested in how you get from middle Pleistocene humans who, if Sarah's right, were already cooperative breeders, cooperating in small groups, how you then create selection for a psychology that allows us to cooperate in very large groups with people we don't know very well, and create moral systems in which we're always looking over everybody else's shoulder. I think that the capacity of humans to acquire information culturally and to cumulatively evolve technologies, I mean, humans are completely 100% dependent on knowledge and tools and things that they acquire by social learning. So if I put you on an Arctic beach, Alan, and I ask you to make a kayak or a snow house or whatever, unless you've spent a lot of time there, you're going to fail. And the same thing is true if I put you in the Ituri forest and ask you to make a living hunting duikers by nets, or if I put you in the Kalahari and ask you to, you know, make poisoned arrows. All that, the ability that humans have, we're completely dependent on this body of socially transmitted information. And a lot of it is about how our neighbors should behave, how other people should behave, and my belief is that the rapidity of cultural evolution, the thing that makes it work is it allows different groups in different places to behave differently. That generates cultural differences between groups that leads to a kind of cultural group selection that favors pro-social behavior amongst unrelated people. And so it builds on the emotions and other kinds of psychology, empathy and so on, that arose in this earlier period of, I mean, Sarah's picture, which I think is quite plausible, was a cooperative breeding.
You bring up something that is very close to one of the questions I had in mind that came to the surface in this past year interviewing all these people around the world, and that was that at some point we started to get together and cooperate and have a very a relationship that served both sides among people who were not kin, who didn't necessarily know each other. And I got really interested in this idea of at some point there was the advent of symbolism among humans. And let me show you this clip that's very, very interesting on this subject. I'd like to know what you think of it. John Shea is making beads from soapstone in the same way our ancestors did in Africa shortly before they turned up in Europe.
The key thing in human evolution is when people start devoting just ridiculous amounts of time to making these objects. Now imagine we live in two different groups, but we don't speak the same language, we don't really know each other, but each of us have one of these beads. Now that bead tells us that we're part of the same network. We may not know each other, but probably if we examine our connections, we'll trace ourselves back to a common group identity or a common ancestor. That gives us a reason to cooperate. It tricks us into thinking we're kin and have a reason to cooperate when we're not really that closely related. And that's a very powerful social institution. It extends the network of cooperation beyond the community of people who know each other directly every day to a potentially infinite range of cooperating individuals. And you can see this today. Fraternity rings, sorority pins, national flags. These allow us to scale up the number of people who cooperate beyond 5 or 10 people who live with each other every day to potentially everybody on the planet. It's a very powerful adaptive strategy, and it's uniquely human. No other primate, no other mammal has ever figured out how to do this.
We don't usually think of body ornaments as being evolutionarily important.
Yeah.
But in this case, it may be one of the, they're standing for a change in social organization that allowed Neanderthals to be replaced by moderns.
You know, what I wonder is, about something that John Shea says in his writing. He talks about a fictive kinship where by virtue of the symbols that are shared, people, a common flag, a religion, of religious practices, dietary practices, by sharing that together, we have the impression that we're kin with these other people with whom we do not share genes. Now, does that play into your group selection, or don't you need it?
Well, it certainly does play into it. Let me back up, if I might.
Just sure. Quickly.
I don't want to give a lecture, but if there are two very different questions that are rotating in our minds here. The first is, what started it? Mm-hmm. In other words, why were human level of altruism so rare in big animals? And the second question is, what was the, after it had been started, what was the process that drove it? These are what we call the ultimate factors that create social creatures in this case. And the consequences that we witness that were produced by the evolutionary process are the proximate. These are our adaptations that allow us in groups to be more successful in competition with other groups. The competition doesn't mean necessarily war, although in humans it has characteristically been war. In recent geological history, it can be just competition. Which groups survive in hard times, or which groups are more adapted to finding new sources?
Competing for the available food sources?
That's right. Yeah. It doesn't have to be open aggression, right. But I think in humans it's characteristically been that, mm-hmm. at late stages of evolution. Anyway, let me just back up and tell you the background for the ultimate and proximate explanations that really constitutes one of the big remaining problems in biology. I was, in fact, in the office of Paul Kurtz this afternoon, and the president of Rockefeller. And he and I were talking about this in reference to biological theory, you know, and explaining biology, and we both agreed that this is one of the great problems, and we really haven't come to grips with it. But when you do, you begin to see more clearly what the problems are concerning what drove our lineage into, in a very late stage in evolution, of mammalian evolution, along this pathway. And what were the consequences, were the processes that all these people like Tomasello and Boyd and Richardson and Sarah Hrdy are analyzing in detail. They are studying particularly the results of how it was produced that led us to this combination of genes and culture and evolution. Well, here's the question. Why is collateral altruism, which we're talking about, we're not talking about mom and infant. That goes all the way back. There are mother bugs that will fight to the death to protect their little brood. Sarah has pointed out correctly that the really interesting thing is cooperative breeding, so that individuals will take care of the young of the others. Now let me then come to the key issue of what triggers the altruistic, collateral altruistic behavior and moves it up into highly organized societies. There are two big examples of these kinds of societies. One of the social insects, which you kindly mentioned, and which, as I said, dominate the world of insects. There are four times, the world has four times as much weight in ants alone as all the land vertebrates combined. They own the world, literally. And termites are a close second, sort of thing. So when you go out into the world of insects, you are moving through a very advanced social world. Now let's go back through history, and I won't take more than another 3 minutes. Don't start
getting... I'm not panicking.
Don't show evidence of restlessness.
No, I haven't.
Anyway, here's the story. Stop that. Here's the story. Life had been on the planet for several billion years, and there are some evidences of collateral altruism, very primitive in a few groups like bacteria and some other organisms, but it never went very far. After all, bacteria don't have big brains, you know, have much in the way of brain. Now we come to the Devonian period and the appearance of insects. Insects take over the terrestrial world along with a primitive vertebrate animal. And in the late Paleozoic, over a period of a couple hundred million years, insects spread through the world and they create an enormous radiation of species and life forms, including modern beetles and dragonflies and a few other groups, but also groups that were later to become extinct. And they're there for tens of millions of years evolving, and they never produced a social insect, you know, an advanced social insect. Now comes the end of the Permian, one of the biggest extinction crisis of all time. And the insects emerge early in the Triassic and spread and become dominant again. But it is not until the Jurassic, tens of millions later, that the first social insects appear. And then today, when you look over the whole world of creatures other than primates, humans, that have achieved that level of evolution and thereby become dominant, you find that there are only about 20 examples among living cases of all of the millions of species we know of that did that. Now we move forward and into the Jurassic and the Cretaceous, and everyone is familiar with the dinosaurs, including forms that are bipedal, running around with hands, and decent-sized brains, none do it. Now we come into the age of mammals. And one little group, the primates, start showing things like alloparental care and cooperative breeding. Okay, that's fine. But we go on through a long, long period in which mammals are dominant before finally we come to the pre-human, this vast array of walking apes in Africa, and lines that lead up almost to the starting point. And then finally, kaboom, one line.
What was that boom? What happened?
That's the question.
That's the question.
All right, now, let me tell you, I'm going to back off, because that, off human, because then what happened was that the brain, particularly the forebrain, evolves at a faster rate than almost any known organ. It really takes off. And you have to look to trends like those that have been delineated by Mike Tomasello, to get a hint of what's going on. And I won't elaborate, but a lot of it had to do with intentionality and reading intentionality.
So the acute sociability,
exactly.
The socializing that we have. We read one another's faces. I try to understand what you're thinking of me and what you're thinking of Sarah, who's thinking of Dominic and all the way, we're all trying to figure out what everybody's thinking.
That's right? The result that really powered the whole, these were the steps. And here at Rockefeller University, Donald Pfaff, for example, has investigated pretty thoroughly some of the neurobiology of this. And we're beginning to understand what kind of changes occurred in the brain and why they included a leveling effect, so that human beings tend to try to keep people around them at their level without letting it run away with ape-like dominance.
But let me—I don't know why, but I have this feeling we skipped over the boom part.
All right, that's what I'm going to give you.
Oh, because Sarah was ready to give us two. But okay. Well, let Sarah break in.
Sure.
She was nodding her head at that.
I've talked enough for my whole evening.
No.
But
no.
If Sarah doesn't give you the right boom, I will.
You will. Okay. Okay. You're on.
You used to study boom and bust. So. Oh. I want to go back to Ed's point about Tomasello and what he's showing. He did these wonderful tests. They have a specially designed battery of sociocognitive tests so that they can compare other apes, chimpanzees, and orangutans with 2.5-year-old children, somewhat like what we saw. And the amazing thing is that in terms of spatial ability or quantitative skills, are they many or few, or in terms of causality, if I push something with a stick, what'll happen? The chimpanzees, 106 chimpanzees, 32 orangutans, 105 2.5-year-old kids, tested all in about the same range. Where they differed, and in terms of memory, you know, that chimpanzee in Japan that Matsuzawa said, that gal can punch little things on a computer screen and remember the order better than his graduate students. I mean, so in terms of these skills, we're in the same ballpark. Yeah. Where we differ is in these social skills, having to do with communication, reading a point, social learning, being able to imitate someone else solving a problem, and in terms of what you were just talking about, theory of mind, and reading someone's intentions, and it's more than just reading them, it's caring about what they want to do. So apes have all these cognitive and manipulative abilities, but they're just not on the same emotional plane. To find a primate that's on that kind of emotional plane, you have to go to very distant relatives with tiny little brains, not able to solve these tasks in the same ways, but they're cooperative breeders, so that infants grow up dependent on help from a number of others and reading them. So marmosets and tamarins, the quintessential cooperative breeders, are extraordinarily good at social learning. teaching is very, very rare in all animals, but these guys come about the closest of any of the primates. And these giving impulses, they would be, Judith Burkhardt, the University of Zurich, has films very much like the one that Carl von Franz de Waal showed us at the beginning in your clip of the chimps pulling. I suspect there was a lot of socialization and training going on. Marmosets will come, if they see someone struggling with something like that, will come rushing over to help. And they offer food spontaneously and voluntarily, just like the human children do. They are not human children. Cognitively, they're not in the same ballpark. They live in a different sensory world. It's a world of smells and not sight. But, so just join me in this thought experiment. Take an ape with the cognitive abilities of orangutans and chimpanzees and our last common ancestors, then introduce cooperative breeding, and you get these emotional and psychological transformations, these developmental, as well as selection for the infants who are best at coping with multiple caretakers. And what do you think you get? That's your boom.
And yet there's still this mysterious element that seems to be missing for the boom to take place, because how do you add that caring? How do you add the cooperative breeding? Where does that come from?
Why do you add it? That's the question.
Well, that's what I'm saying, yeah.
Yeah, why?
Well, where does it come from? What? Well, there's always a chicken and an egg here. Every time we get down, there's an egg before that and a chicken
I want to hear more, but I just want to say at this point for clarification, that what Sarah has done is, as you know, the rocket metaphor, we're going to get the boom. But she's lined up the rockets. And now, with the right conditions for the boom, now we're going to light the fire, as they say at Cape Canaveral. And boom, what happened? Now, I'm not going to tell you because I'll tell you, but I want to hear more from others.
Well,
first.
I was thinking of you, Xavier, when Sarah was talking about this. Once you added you had these conditions that were just right. They sound like the conditions necessary for you to have this compassion that you talk about as the essence of cooperation and possibly altruism.
Looking back to what we had a little bit before, you know, you said, in front of the children, the whole people there were moved, you know, they really thought of it. But I think there is the same feeling with mentally handicapped or with old people, you know. Each time you find fragility, you find something that somebody who is a little bit weak, or, you know, there is a tendency normally among the people to really be pulled to them. And I'll take an example that to me has been an extraordinary example, which has been confirmed recently by the work of Jane Renfrew, for example, which is the behavior of the Neanderthal man. Now, that was people between 50,000 and 100,000 before now. Now, they have found repeatedly, but I'll take one example, which is extraordinary. It's a man from Iraq, you know, that was probably between 60 and 100,000 years ago, that they found he had been interred in a tomb, and he was heavily physically handicapped. He could not use his right leg from his birth, apparently. He had one arm missing. He had half of the face, which had been blown out by some blow or something, and everything had been able to heal. And he was about 40 years old when he died, and they interred him. And it's remarkable because they did not put everybody in the town, only a few of them. And when you think of that, that means the people agree that they had to take care of this guy, you know, to put them on their back, to feed them, at a time where they were hunter-gatherers, so they were moving along, you know, every day they had to take the guy, move along, and so on. And why did they decide, you know, a group of 15 or 20 people probably, to completely change their life to take care of this guy? I mean, this is the real mystery behind, you know, not only altruism, but compassion. Mm-hmm. Why did they decide that it was so important to completely change the community around this person? I think this is the most important thing. And when you look, that was 50 to 100,000 years ago, but we have many other examples, much more recent, of course, but you find it every day in communities, in families, and so on. Why did man invent this extraordinary thing, which is not only do I take care of small children, after all, mammals do that in general, but I take care of those who, from the Darwinian sense, are not useful anymore. Mm-hmm. Why did we decide to do that? But and I think this is the real big question behind altruism.
You raise another question in my mind, which is, as we talk about this capacity for compassion, as we talk about this demonstration we all had, every one of us, I was watching you, all of us, we all responded to the children. The greatest cooperation that we show, and often the greatest altruism, is in war. Mm-hmm. Now, that seems to be a contradiction. And the question arises, and you might have some different views on this among you, did we know how to cooperate and therefore get good at war, or were we getting good at war and learn how to cooperate through that? What do you all think? What do you think, Rob?
I think the first. I think what I think is that war is just a scaling up of, there's always conflict. And when you can cooperate, you can have conflict amongst bigger groups, because conflict almost always involves altruism in the sense that I'm a fighter, I put my life on the line, I take risks in the interest of victory, and the benefits flow to everyone, whether they, you know, whether they hide behind a tree or fight. And so warfare is an example participation in warfare is an example of cooperation. You can have very small groups in the case of chimpanzees, bigger groups in the case of human hunter-gatherers, and bigger yet in the case of agriculturalists, and finally you end up with, you know, the Verdun or the Somme or someplace where hundreds of thousands of men are, you know, running across a muddy field, almost certain that they're going to die in order to defend France or England or whatever it is. And I think that the more altruistic you get, in the sense of the wider the universe of people to whom you feel you owe altruistic behavior, then that leads to larger scale conflict, because you can mobilize bigger groups of people to cooperate or to be altruistic.
But which do you think came first?
Well, I think there was always conflict. And I think there was, in the time scales we're talking about, there was always cooperation. The question is, what scaled it from me and my brother, or me and my sister, or me and my daughter, to me and 5 or 10 other people in my band, to me and the 500 people in my clan, to me and the 500,000 people, you know, in my division or whatever it is. So at every stage, you've got both motives to cooperate and motives to get stuff from other people. And the puzzle is, what caused the scale of cooperation to increase? And I think the increase in scale comes first, and then the warfare comes afterwards. It's not the warfare generates the larger scale cooperation. It's cooperation enables larger scale conflict.
Did you have a response to that?
Oh, actually, we used our communication skills and language in particular ahead of time to work out our differences. But,
cooperatively.
You know, one reason I really wanted to participate tonight is I wanted to hear Ed talk about this very issue in terms of the overall history of the social insects, the primitive eusocial creatures with shared care, and then these extraordinarily elaborate eusocial creatures where you have something with so many parallels.
Just take
to
a
human
second
warfare.
To define eusocial, because I think
well, the world's expert on eusociality is on
a
my
a quick
right.
definition, because the rest of the question is lengthy, I bet.
A tightly lit.
Don't forget my right foot.
Okay. I'll wait until the between the urgent 15 seconds left, sir, left foot starts tapping. Anyway, yeah, eusocial means the presence of groups tightly organized with division of labor based upon castes that are reproductive and those like worker ants are not.
Okay. So that right. in a colony, right. the queen would give birth, but all these other workers would take care of the offspring and not the queen herself.
Yes,
but they're not getting necessarily their own genes protected.
No, that's right. That's eusociality, but okay. Of course their genes are very close to the mother. But anyway, okay, the boom.
I'll get back to the boom. Okay.
What I'm going to do is very swiftly.
Yes, we'll see.
Okay. I'm watching. Can I hold this so that I know when it starts to tremble a little bit?
Go ahead, very swiftly.
Okay, I'll be very quickly.
No, go ahead.
Okay, because this is something I've worked a lot on with colleagues just in the last 5 years. And for those who want to examine the argument, which is now, it's controversial, but I think we've really got it. The articles by me and various colleagues in bioscience and the Quarterly Review of Biology, American Science and Proceedings of the National Academy can be found by easy search for the detail.
Well, if I can here, plug my show, you can plug your paper.
Okay, well, no, I was telling you, this is not out of the blue.
No, of course.
Okay.
Yeah,
here's what happened. We want to know why it was so rare, and then to answer that question, why it happened. Here's what happened in the social insects. In all of these radiating lines of evolution, a very few of them, happenstance, just by normal Darwinian evolution, produced a form of nest construction accompanying mother care in which a female mated, built a fairly elaborate nest, think hornet nest or mud dauber, and then began to provision the young by laying an egg in, and then as the egg hatched into the larva, going out and getting food. So she had a nest. It was a lot went into building it. It was one, and she progressively provisioned it, and it's in an area that has fairly rich resources. That was the precondition. Had nothing to do with social behavior in the sense that we're talking about. Altruism toward collateral relatives. It takes only one gene change to erase the tendency of the young to depart and the mother to move on and build another nest. One gene. We've learned that from Evo Devo, that it can be that simple.
Say what Evo Devo is.
Oh, evolutionary development. Evolution of development.
Okay.
One little change. And now what happens? Normally that would not go anywhere. But if there's such a great advantage, and this is what we don't fully understand yet, to having a group of collateral relatives cooperating altruistically, a big advantage somehow from the environment, this is group selection pressure, then it will overcome the tendency towards selfish behavior and independent behavior, and that has happened very rarely. So now the focus of research in the social insects is shifting to away from the notion of kinship. This is group selection, and is shifting now to a close examination of those cases in which the transition has just been made, and we might figure out what the final push was. Some argue that group selection is just another form of kin selection. That is, one can be translated into other. It's called the theory of inclusive fitness. But that is nonsense. It's mathematically cannot be, even though some have. But I won't go into that now. Now we come to humans. And what's worth thinking about in explaining what happened, what was the big push, we need to be looking, and in fact, serious anthropologists and others have been looking for the preconditions. So we have, as Sarah points out, one necessary precondition probably is to have a big animal with a big brain, for mammals anyway. Bipedalism is often given. Life on savanna, for various reasons, promotes movement. The tendency to have a sight that the bipedalism and the freedom of the hands allows you to come and go. All these things are under consideration. But what they add up to is that, as in the insects, way back, there is a combination, a rare, rare combination of circumstances that just didn't happen to come into existence, happenstance, until these first primates reached a certain size, became bipedal for another reason than sociality. And then you have the driving force behind groups cooperating versus other groups and against solitary individual, and the production as a consequence of this, of the rise swiftly of intention, reading abilities, and all of these other traits, including the emotions of care, empathy, and the cooperation of altruistic.
Could I interrupt just to make sure I understand?
Yeah, I finished.
No, I just went, oh, great.
Yeah, but
I want to make sure I understand.
You're providing a coda.
I want to make sure I understand what you said.
Okay.
Are you saying that this flowering of caring and so on occurred at the time or around the time of bipedalism, or were somehow produced by it?
Produced by it.
Produced
by the first step, because...
Why? What would it matter? Why would I care more if I can walk?
Well, you do. The group that has these qualities prevails over the group that does not. In fact, if you want to see a first statement of this, that's in The Descent of Man by Darwin.
Uh-huh.
It's a politically incorrect thing, so it doesn't get seen by some as politically incorrect. But Darwin has it there, but just because Darwin said it doesn't mean that it's right.
I think I get it that the group that can walk and get around more easily, like they can use their hands and so on, are in a better position to prevail against groups that can't. But what is there about walking that helps them care more about one another?
No. What happens is that most likely is that they're operating out of a site, a campsite.
Yeah.
A place where some stay behind and while others hunt. And as that evolves, then those groups that have that quality that get more tightly integrated in ability to cooperate and trade and care with empathy and operate efficiently prevail over those that have less of that ability. And that means that genes predisposing people so those mental capacities and emotional responses prevail over, it's still a long period of time, we're talking, you know, hundreds of thousands of years, over those that do not. And this is enough to drive a modification of the sensory system, the emotional centers, and the capacity of the brain to be reading, essentially, the purposes of others.
Dominic, I saw you making a lot of notes. Were you?
Yeah.
I would hate for you to go home with that in your pocket.
Oh, actually, I really would like to hear what he has to say.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I don't disagree with anything that's been said, other than that I think it's important to maintain a healthy skepticism about the individual processes going on as well. So this struck me when we saw the footage of the children helping out. I mean, there's a lot of Machiavellianism going on as well. In the example that Rob was talking about, war. Sure. So yes, it's a collective action problem. Yes, you can benefit as a group, but you can also gain individual benefits even from group activities. So you have to keep those in mind as well. And no one ever doubted that group selection could work in theory. You just had to empirically verify whether the between group processes were more or less powerful than the within group processes. And the within group processes are important to bear in mind too. For this reason. So, I mean, the things that I'm particularly interested in at the moment, we haven't talked about that much, is language as well, and theory of mind. It's sort of extending from the last exposition of how this sort of human development set us up for hypersociality. And you talked about theory of mind as, you know, myself knowing what Sarah's thinking and what she's thinking about Ed. But there's also myself thinking about what Sarah thinks about me. Mm-hmm. So I think the really interesting thing about theory of mind from the perspective of cooperation is self-monitoring. All of a sudden, as Rob says, we have these norms that we were supposed to abide by as a community, and all of a sudden we have the capacity to be very concerned about whether we're fulfilling these norms. And then as soon as you have that, you have reputation management and all sorts of complex strategies to try and look like you're a good cooperator, whether you are or not. And then you have the very important role of language, right? So I mentioned indirect reciprocity at the beginning, this idea that I can be apparently altruistic, but in doing so, I'm attracting cooperative activities from other people.
Just get into the difference between direct reciprocity and indirect reciprocity, because I get the impression that indirect reciprocity is very much human, more than other primates. Is that correct, or am I off the track with that?
Indirect reciprocity?
Yeah. Well, just say what the difference is between them.
Well, okay, so the difference is that direct reciprocity is, I help you, you help me tomorrow. Indirect reciprocity is, I help you, Sarah realizes I'm a nice guy, she helps me, because then perhaps I'll help her in the future.
Mm-hmm. Or help Rob.
Or she might help Rob, and it can extend to a large community.
Yeah.
Now, you said, is indirect reciprocity more common among humans? Mm. There's actually a lot of people who think even reciprocity is not that common among animals, because for normal reciprocity to work, you have to have the skills to remember who's helped you, how much they've helped you. Mm-hmm. And many people think that that's actually quite limited in a lot of species. So
I think Franz de Waal said to me once that there's some kind of probably unconscious but counting going on. How many good turns you do me, and that's how many I'll do you, and I'll turn my back on you if you don't do the right number for me.
Right, exactly. So it's somewhat
limited.
Among
chimps I'm talking about.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Right.
So it's somewhat limited by cognitive ability, and then indirect reciprocity is particularly interesting because it does seem to be something which sort of catches fire in humans. And this is where I think language is very important. Martin Novak, we talked about before the session this evening, thinks that language is really the motivating power behind indirect reciprocity in humans, because all of a sudden, Sarah can decide I'm a good cooperator by hearing about me through someone else. She doesn't even need to see it happen. So, you know, that's a very simple sounding difference, but imagine the massive effects that has on gossip, reputation management, status, and all of the ramifications that has for group cooperation. So I think language is critical. Mm-hmm. And to back up some of what Rob was saying, language also helps cultural evolution happen faster, because you can have imitation and teaching happen at a much faster scale than you can in other forms of evolution. So all of a sudden, with the development of theory of mind and language, you've got self-monitoring, reputation management, and the world just opened up to possibilities for cooperation.
I get the impression from hearing all of you talk and the people I talked with around the world, that there seems to be a kind of a feedback mechanism between our genes, our genetic inheritance, and the culture around us, and that evolution seems to have given us a little boost, which created a cultural response, which may have moved us further in a direction through selection to another little genetic boost, and that this back and forth process may have been the essence of what on the program we were calling the human spark, but tonight we've been calling the boom.
it may not
be the one thing you can point to, but a complex interaction of things over time that make it hard for us to say it's this that's the thing that gave us the initial impetus.
You're speaking of, yes, something called gene culture coevolution.
I had no idea.
I must be
incredibly smart.
No, remember that we've continued to talk about the consequences of the driving force of group selection. That's what we've been talking about.
Yeah.
But in the course of this, when culture appears on the scene, and I'm ready to call upon my colleague, Rob Boyd here, particularly who's actually a specialist in this field as well, that genetic changes occur. And of course, human beings all through their history have been going through rapid dynamism of new mutations, selection, and change, with most of the group's responses being due to group selection on what we call emergent properties. So those are the properties that come from interaction of people within a group. And as mutations occur that predispose people to learn certain things quickly, complexly, or to have a strong emotional response about certain things they do or learn, then you have a constant jacking up of those responses that we've been talking about that make us human. Mm. And the psychologists have the title, have something they call prepared learning and counter-prepared learning. Certain things become very easy for human beings to do, think about, learn. Certain things become very difficult or even repellent. And the result is then a kind of program capacity to acquire culture more rapidly than others. There is a list that can be made of inherited tendencies, yes, genetically based predispositions to learn certain things and avoid them. We have examples of these, and I'm not going to list them unless you give me another hour. But they, but they exist, and we're now getting down to learning what the genetic basis of them is and at what stages in development, usually postnatal, that these are acquired propensities. For example, the resistance to incest and others, many other examples. And that's something that the psychologists who are taking an evolutionary viewpoint are beginning to investigate more closely.
Did you have something to contribute to that?
I agree absolutely that we have lots of evidence, I think, that
the
existence of culture in the human lineage has led to lots of changes, and the easiest ones to point to are morphological changes.
So, yeah, I got some of that from his book.
You see, there's a perfect example of the collegiality and cooperation.
I recorded his intentionality over there.
If you hadn't mentioned you got it from his book and he let it go, that would be altruism.
Oh, right. That's true.
We do need to bring it to a close. I'm so grateful to all of you for coming tonight. I think this is a perfect example of cooperation in science, of people listening to one another with respect and challenging everything. It's what makes science fun, I think, is the uncertainty, the searching for some kind of hint of what may be true when you don't really know where it's going to be found. And I'm very grateful for the diversity of views you brought to this tonight. When we started, I was a little confused, but now I'm gloriously, richly, excitedly confused.
Okay.
Thank you all for coming tonight. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Great that you could be here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.